Welcome to the People Who Read People podcast with me, Zach Elwood. This is a podcast about understanding human behavior. You can learn more about it at behavior-podcast.com. On today's episode, recorded December 3rd, 2021, I interview Eric Pisa, who's an associate professor of criminal justice at John Jay College of Criminal Justice. I talked to Eric about how video surveillance impacts crime. Has the rise in video technology resulted in less criminal behavior? Other things we talk about include what research says about the effectiveness of police body cams, the role that America's huge number of guns play in violence by police, and maybe something that's more practically useful for you. We talk a little bit about strategies for preventing crime at your home or business. A little background about why I was interested to talk to someone about the societal impacts of video technology. I myself have a video film degree. Mainly, I've used those skills for some commercial video production work, but I once worked for a very short time as a forensic video analyst, which involved getting a few weeks certification on forensic video analysis procedures, and then doing some work analyzing a few videos for law enforcement and legal purposes. This is just to explain why I'm interested in video topics. One thing I've sometimes wondered is how much photography and video technology have changed the modern world in terms of affecting people's willingness to engage in bad and antisocial behavior. And I'm not just talking about crime, but also about murders, including politically motivated killings and atrocities. Because it seems pretty well established that we're living in the safest time in history, meaning that a person living now has less chance of being murdered or killed than at any previous point in history. Is it possible some of that reduction in violent crime in modern history could be due to the civilizing effects of photography and film and video technology? Clearly, there are many factors about the modern world that have increased both our ethics and our sense of personal accountability. But it seems to me that beginning with photography, the ability to record human activities made it easier to see when people were behaving badly. It created more opportunity for shame and for consequences. For one example, you can find books and papers about how photography helped end child labor. When people saw how children were being treated, they were motivated to do something about it. And for another example, surely the American Civil Rights Movement would have been less effective if people weren't able to see and hear the disparity of how black and white people were being treated, if they weren't able to visually see the abuses and injustice. Without such recordings, it's a lot easier to ignore things. And along with that increased societal awareness, it seems like people would be increasingly aware of how they might be judged and ostracized and punished for their bad behavior. For example, with the attention George Floyd and other recent video recordings of killings by police have gotten, surely cops are more cognizant about what may befall them if they do something wrong or if they overreact. Regarding politically or racially motivated atrocities, those are apparently in decline too. Steven Pinker wrote a book called The Better Angels of Our Nature. It was about the reduction in violence over humanity's history. To quote from the website Our World in Data, which references Pinker's book, the rate of deaths resulting from genocides around the world has been on a downward trend since its peak during the Second World War, end quote. Is it possible some of that is due to increased surveillance and the increased likelihood of facing consequences and punishments? It's hard to imagine it wouldn't have some effect. And then there's the big crime drop in the U.S. where violent crime and murder dropped off hugely. In New York City in the 90s, to quote from a paper, violent crime declined by more than 56% in the city, compared to about 28% in the nation as a whole. Property crimes tumbled by about 65%, but fell only 26% nationally. Is it possible some of that drop was due to video surveillance systems, which were just starting to become pretty common at that point? There are, of course, a lot of theories about why that drop happened, and it's likely it was a combination of factors, as most big societal changes tend to be. But in any case, these are the kinds of things I was curious about that led me wanting to talk to Eric. And clearly, some of these things I've mentioned are very big and broad questions that neither Eric nor I know much about, but I wanted to explain what interests me about these topics, as I might do later episodes on related topics. A little more about Eric Pisa. He's an expert in spatial analysis of crime patterns, problem-oriented policing, crime control technology, and GIS mapping. He served as the GIS specialist of the Newark, New Jersey Police Department, the research director for crime analytics of the Rutgers Center on Public Security, and the Research Program Coordinator of the Police Institute. He's received several awards, including three from the National Institute of Justice. You can learn more about him at his website, ericpiza.net. That's Eric, P-I-Z-A. And you can follow him on Twitter. His handle is Pisa Eric. Okay, here's the interview with Eric Pisa. Hi, Eric. Thanks for coming on.
Thank you for having me.
Maybe a good place to start is talking about the idea that the well-known big decrease in crime that happened in the 90s and onward, how much of that do you think is due to surveillance camera technology and the ubiquity of video surveillance technology, if you're able to say that?
It's tough to say directly, right? Because we have no accurate measures of exactly how common video surveillance has been over time. We know that today it is quite common. Most cities, certainly in the United States and United Kingdom and also some other countries, do have some type of video surveillance system, but it's difficult to track exactly how that grew dating back decades. But to be honest, if I take an honest assessment of what the research tells us about video surveillance cameras, my gut would say that they didn't have a whole lot to do with the crime decrease of the 1990s.
Is it accurate to say that the big crime decrease, it seems like that most people think that it had multiple factors involved. Is that accurate to say?
Yeah, that's certainly accurate. And the tough thing is the way that we prefer to learn is in research is to have all of the variables of interest under control, right? So we would prefer as researchers to experiment, to carefully introduce programs that we think would impact crime, and then to sit back and compare that to a counterfactual condition, right? All of these things that are really difficult to do in social science, right? Especially when we want to look backwards and we want to say what was responsible for something like the crime decline, right? It's difficult to say because there's so many competing factors. We can't retroactively, obviously, go back in time and control when those factors are introduced into society. So that's why even today, there still is quite a bit of debate over what exactly caused the crime decline.
When it comes to surveillance video technology, I think most people would have an intuitive sense that it makes people behave better. I think most people can have that feeling of like, oh, there's video nearby, I'm going to behave better. But clearly the intuitions we have don't necessarily line up with research. And maybe you can talk a little bit about why it seems so intuitive and yet why it's so complicated to make that comparison.
Well, right. Yeah. I mean, it seems like a simple idea, right? And I think that everyday way of thinking about this is who would be dumb enough to commit crime on camera, right? And when you look carefully at the research, right, there's two answers that I think a layperson can understand. The first is actually a significant amount of people are willing to commit crime in front of a camera. But the more important follow-up to that is I would contend that they're actually not acting dumb, that they're actually not behaving stupidly. And what I mean by that is it's one thing to have the ability to observe areas and observe people committing crime. It's quite a different, separate thing to actually increase the risk that any observed criminal behavior will actually result in punishment. And where a lot of surveillance systems has fallen short, right, but my research really highlights this, is that police can fall into the trap of thinking that just putting up a camera by itself is going to be sufficient to convince people to not commit crime in public. And again, that's not true. What we see over and over is that standalone video surveillance systems really don't have much impact, right? We see the effect of video surveillance cameras are heightened when they're instituted alongside other proactive activities. They're heightened when people are actively monitoring the cameras and when police have the capacity to respond pretty quickly to things that these people report viewing on camera. Mm-hmm. And that's a little bit more difficult to achieve in practice than I think the average person understands.
Is it fair to say the problem there is that people committing crimes, criminals quickly find out that police are not doing a good job with those cameras. Is that basically what's happening? And would it be different if it was clear that the police were actually actively monitoring things and doing something about it?
Yeah, exactly, right? I mean, what research shows is that offenders report not being afraid of cameras because they don't think that the police can respond quickly enough to mm-hmm. observed infractions to actually have a deterrent effect. Mm-hmm. And for my own research, digging into, you know, to the research that I've done, they're not wrong, right? They're not wrong. I mean, one of the main problems is that video surveillance cameras are tied into, for the most part, this is the default in most cities that I'm aware of, they're tied into the default dispatch processes of police. Right, police don't have a car ready to go, right, revved up in a garage to speed out immediately to every call, right? That's mm-hmm. obvious. They have to respond to calls on a priority level, right? Higher priority calls get responded to quicker than lower priority calls, right? Now, that sounds well enough, and that's fine, and I don't think many people would argue against that. But the problem with something like video surveillance is you're watching incidents in real time, and it's not always automatic that high priority equals seriousness. Mm-hmm. And pardon me for going on this tangent, right? But a great example that I like to say is that the city I worked in, I worked for the Newark Police Department before I became an academic, right? So let's say that we have three different calls. One's coded as a 744, one's coded as a 644, one's coded as a 544. Obviously, the sevens and sixes have to get taken care of before we go to the five. The problem with that is seven is an electric line down. Six, well, the 644 is a flooded street. 544 is a suspicious person who might be carrying a firearm, right? Now, flooded streets, down electric lines, those are incredibly important things that police need to respond to, right? But I would contend that the 544 in this example is the only one that might turn into a homicide because someone might be carrying a firearm. The nature of video surveillance is what they're watching and what these operators are viewing on camera a lot of the time falls into that suspicious category that might be something incredibly important. But unless the person pulls the gun out and starts firing in the air and they can confirm that, yes, that indeed is a firearm that this person is carrying, the police are not going to respond to that incident until they handle other incidents. So mm-hmm. the rapid response that we're kind of bluffing with, to be perfectly frank, right? We put up cameras to send the message that if you misbehave, if you break the law, there's going to be swift consequences, right? When we get into the practical response to what's observed on cameras, it's anything but swift.
Mm-hmm. It's true that some studies do show a reductive effect too. Is that true? Because I was reading one study in Montevideo, Uruguay, where they were claiming that it showed a reduction there. So there are some studies, right, that show that?
There are. And myself and my colleagues, Brandon Welsh from Northeastern University, David Farrington from Cambridge University, and Amanda Thomas, one of my PhD students from John Jay, we recently completed a systematic review and meta-analysis of the video surveillance literature. And essentially, we found 80 studies that allowed us to pull the overall effects. But more importantly, I think it allowed us to isolate factors associated with heightened video surveillance effects. And what we found a number of things, but I think in the context of this conversation, the most important finding is when we found that video surveillance cameras deployed absent any other complementary interventions had no significant effect. The projects or the programs rather that deployed video surveillance alongside other interventions that introduced this type of proactive policing that I'm talking about, and also other situational crime prevention measures, those are the ones that had the highest effect, right? So again, this notion that if we just put up cameras, everyone's going to be afraid to commit a crime, right? That's false. That's false. And I think the research literature is pretty clear on that.
Is there a distinction made between preventing crime at a specific shop or house versus preventing it generally? So for example, are you still saying it would be mostly untrue that even putting it up at a specific shop wouldn't help, or are we talking more about like it would just be displaced in a general area and would still generally happen as much?
Well, actually, so interesting you said that, because one of the other main findings that we found was that video surveillance cameras work best in parking lots. We use the term car park in our research only because so much of this research has been done in the UK, and that's what they call them on that side of the pond. But car parks, parking lots, whatever we want to call them, those are the settings where video surveillance camera effects are the highest. Residential areas were the second type of area where video surveillance cameras seem to have a heightened effect. So again, that tells you that there's a lot of context to this, right? So it's not just put up a camera and your crime prevention work is done. It's really understand the nature of your crime problem, understand the environments that you're trying to do something about crime, understand the policies you have in place about how you're going to actually police the areas covered by cameras. All of that is going to play a large role in whether or not the cameras succeed in preventing crime.
All that said, is it fair to say that if you had a shop, you'd be putting a camera up?
Not necessarily.
Oh, really?
My parents actually have a shop, right? So my parents are small business owners. They've owned a party shop for over 25 years now, I think. And I always make fun of them because they make fun is too harsh. I don't make fun of my parents. I'm a nice person. I always speak to them about the inefficiency of the way that they have their cameras placed, right? Mm-hmm. So they have a couple of cameras in the shop, but the way it's positioned, you really can't make out anyone's face, right? And to kind of test this one day, I walked into their shop when it was fairly busy without telling them. And then I left and came back a day later and I asked them to pull up the video and find me, and they couldn't because, again, the camera was so far away from the door, you couldn't really make out faces. Same thing with the outside. So my parents' truck for their business has been stolen twice. Mm-hmm. Both times the person is seen on camera, right in front of the camera. I would think it would be pretty hard to miss the camera. Again, right, just kind of stole the van on two different occasions. And the entire event is caught on camera and no one was ever identified or prosecuted.
Right.
And again, I find it hard to believe that the person didn't notice that there was a camera. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So that's just a much too long way to say that if I owned a shop, I might do other things besides spend my money on video surveillance cameras.
Yeah, I've actually got my own story about that. I helped a friend in Portland, Oregon. He had had a truck broken into when he was in a place for like an hour, and he had gotten like $70,000 worth of video equipment stolen from some clearly professional thieves. You know, they kind of went around looking for the best thing to break into, and they did it. And I actually went around and myself, because the cops didn't do anything, I went around and got the surveillance footage from like four different cameras. And they didn't really care.
Kudos to you.
Yeah, but sort of to your point, it was like we found all this video, and all that video would have been taped over very quickly if we had just let the cops do it. You know, they clearly didn't. To your point, they were very busy doing other things. Apparently, I would have thought it, you know, such a big theft, they would have paid attention to, because it was pretty clearly professional. But anyway, we got all this footage together and had some pretty good shots of their faces and gave it to the cops, and nothing happened with it. And so, and I think it was interesting too, to your point, it's like these people were clearly professional. Like they were casing multiple cars and it took them quite a while. Yeah. You could see them circling for almost an hour before they found a car that they wanted that had, you know, good stuff in it. And they didn't care about videos either. Yeah.
Yeah, because the thing is too, right? I mean, we have a bad habit in policing, but I should kind of make a broader statement, right? Just in society, like we think technology is going to solve all of our problems, right? I mean, we mm-hmm. look at technology like it's an easy button, right? And crime prevention is certainly, you know, fall into that trap. Oh, we have a crime problem. Let's put up cameras. We have a community relations problem. Let's strap cameras to the chest mm-hmm. of cops. And, you know, and we fail to realize that the human factors behind the technology, the decisions, the policies, that is really what's going to determine whether or not these technologies work, right? Mm-hmm. My students make fun of me all of the time, right? Because the analogy I always use is a refrigerator, right? I always say, Video surveillance cameras, body cameras, whatever technology we happen to be talking about in class, right? I said it's not a refrigerator, right? And what I mean by that is refrigerators, that's a pretty simple technology, right? You get the refrigerator into your house, you plug it into the wall, you put your food in it. You don't have to put any other thought into the refrigerator. It's done its job. That's not how crime control works. That's not how social control works. That's not how criminal investigations work, right? The technology is just a tool. There's a whole host of other things that you have to take care of to make sure the technology works.
And it seems like we get so desensitized to things. It's like when we're surrounded by all, surveillance or whatever technology, it kind of just becomes background noise because nothing really is being done with it. And it's sort of the same way you can collect all this data from people online, you know, visitors to your site or whatever, and you're kind of swimming in data, but without the actual strategy to get information out of that or do something with it, it's kind of useless.
That's an excellent point. And going back to both your and my story about the lack of successful investigation outcomes despite video evidence, this is an incredible amount of data that's being collected, right? I mean, think of the hours and hours of footage that are on a camera and the manpower or analytical expertise, if you wanted to automate it, necessary to actually make sense of all of that information. That's frankly out of, that's beyond the capacity of most police agencies to make sense of this amount of video footage. Mm-hmm.
Are there studies that show an initial effect with new cameras installed and then a slow decline in effectiveness as people become more used to them and know that they're not doing much?
That particular question off the top of my head, I can't think of any studies, but I conducted a study with some colleagues of mine in 2014, where we looked at a related question, not exactly what we're talking about, but we were looking at camera operator vigilance, right? So essentially how many crimes are they detecting and reporting when they're watching the cameras? And what we found was kind of counterintuitively that the more cameras that were installed in the city, the lower number of crimes over time were actually being observed on the cameras, right? So essentially, and after interviewing some of the operators to learn a little bit more about what was going on, what we found was a couple of things, right? One, it just became so overwhelming, right? It became so overwhelming to watch all of those cameras, and they would just not. I mean, like, you know, that they would just kind of, you know, not be able to keep up with the amount of visual information. And the second problem that they identified is what I was alluding to before. They became frustrated when they would see incidents that would lead to some really significant and harmful crimes occurring, and it took the police officers too long to get out there because of the nature by which individuals responded to crime on camera in that city. Mm-hmm. So this puts it in context, right? So when there were 11 cameras, right, very small number of cameras, the camera operators identified and reported on average about 27 crimes on camera per week, right? 11 cameras. When the system expanded to 146 cameras, they were reporting 2 crimes per week, which is kind of mind-blowing, right? That's you have 135 additional cameras to identify crime with, and mm-hmm. you're identifying 18 less incidents per week.
Mm-hmm. So the reason I was initially interested in talking to you was kind of a broader idea I had, and I haven't actually seen much about it, but the idea that the kind of atrocities we used to see in, early 1900s and earlier in history just don't seem as common as these days. And I haven't seen much writing on this. And I'm curious if you have about whether photography and later video were all a part in making the world, making people less likely to commit atrocities. Just curious if you've seen anything about that. It surprised me that I haven't seen anybody writing papers or books about that kind of idea.
I haven't, but I would argue in my field, policing, we've seen more atrocities because of video, right?
Well, yeah, you see more. I guess maybe I phrased it wrong. I guess my idea was that less people are producing them, even if you see more because of it. But it seems pretty clear to me that people are less likely to do horrible things. And I guess I'm just surprised that I haven't seen people write about that topic or do studies on that topic. It might be a broader
I think so,
question,
yeah.
too broad for us to tackle. Yeah. If anyone's listening and has seen, you know, writing or research or thoughts on that, I'd like to know, because it was something I was thinking about and what led me to contact you, actually. When it comes to police body cam footage and that technology, is it fair to say that has helped in reducing bad police behavior?
The research on body cameras is also mixed. So Cynthia Lum and colleagues out of George Mason University, they've done quite a bit of work in, you know, doing systematic reviews and analyses of the body camera research. And, you know, they find, again, a kind of wide degree of variance, right? In certain situations, body cameras seem to work very well. In other situations, they don't have the level of effect that policymakers probably anticipated. And again, in trying to explain why, it's the research is still kind of in the early stages there. But one factor that has been highlighted is the discretionary behavior of police officers in terms of whether or not to turn the cameras on. Mm. Right. First of all, the technology isn't to the point where the camera knows exactly when it's appropriate to record and turns on by itself. Right. It's still a very human operation to, you know, get to the scene, have the wherewithal about exactly what's happening, and manually activate your camera. One factor is it seems that in cities where officers have high level of discretion about exactly when to turn their cameras on, that body cameras are less effective. Mm-hmm. When there's policies in place to make sure that camera activation is mandatory for a wide number of events, or at least events of concern, that seems to be a correlate with effective body camera deployment.
Now, you did some research where they used police body cam footage to study that and improve police interactions and foster more de-escalation. Can you talk a little bit about that? Because that seems like a very interesting use of body cam footage.
Yeah. So, and we were motivated to begin this project due to the fact that the effect of body cameras were so variable in the literature. And my colleague, Victoria Seitzma, and I, in talking about it, we just kind of said, you know, we stumbled upon this notion that in addition to being a prevention tool, body cameras are a pretty important data collection tool, right? If you consider all of the police-citizen interactions that are captured on body camera, right, we're getting a rich look into a very important component of policing that isn't being measured in as much detail anywhere else, right? Mm-hmm. There is no written report that could get at the nuance that you can get at when you're actually viewing the footage. So we're in year two of a project where we've been viewing, coding, and analyzing use of force events captured on body cameras for the purpose of understanding a little bit more the situational dynamics that seem to lead to use of force outcomes. And we're also measuring things like policy adherence. Procedural justice is one thing that everyone is advocating for nowadays. Essentially, we want police to be fair to anyone they encounter, even when they have to stop someone for a law enforcement purpose. We want police to speak respectfully, explain exactly why the situation is unfolding like it is, answer any questions the people or suspects on scene may have. So we've been actually using the body cameras as a policy adherence tool, right? Because we could look, and again, we're not relying on any third party accounts about what happened. We're viewing exactly what happened, and we're able to measure the policy adherence in all of these different types of cases.
A note here, from my last interview, I talked to Saul Albert about conversation analysis, which is about analyzing verbal interactions in a scientific way. Some conversation analysis work has involved studying interactions between suicide prevention specialists and suicidal people to see what verbal patterns work and what doesn't work. And also some researchers have done conversation analysis work on police interactions to see what language is more de-escalating. and what language choices might be more conflict-producing and counterproductive. Also, if police issues interest you, you might like the interviews I did for this podcast with James Mitchell, a retired police captain. In my first talk with him, he talked a lot about the importance of good de-escalation skills in preventing violence from occurring in police-citizen interactions. It seems to me that guns are the main cause of the high rate of U.S. excessive violence by police, and that would seem to be borne out by or supported by some of the body cam. You know, a lot of the body cam footage, police know that they're wearing a body cam and their excessive force is caught on tape, and that would seem to point to, it's not as if they're trying to hide this. It's related to them being scared and freaking out, basically. And that to me is related to, as I see it, the huge role that guns play in this and making the United States so unique in terms of the threats that police face, at least in terms of comparable countries that are often used to compare the U.S. to. And I'm curious what you think of that, and have you seen studies that may be related to police reactions and the role of guns in our society?
I can't think of any related empirical research, but I mean, I happen to agree pretty strongly with you, right? I mean, you know, this is probably the only country or one of the only few countries in the world where a police officer is probably correct to assume that there is a non-negligible likelihood that people they stop, people they interact with, may be armed. So that obviously, right off of the bat, creates a heightened sense of fear, a heightened sense of the defensiveness, and in certain respects, maybe a heightened level of aggression that I would guess wouldn't exist if people just weren't armed so often as they are in this country, right? So I happen to agree with you very much on that.
It's curious to me that I don't see more about that topic. It just seems like such an avoided subject, which is strange because, you know, on the liberal side, at least, people talk so much about the role of guns, and it's just, in other cases anyway, for mass shootings and such, it just seems so strange that it's so absent in this area. And clearly it's obviously absent in the conservative area because, I mean, I tried to have a conversation for the podcast with a former state trooper who was, I couldn't even get him to admit that guns played a role, and ended up not interviewing him for that reason because he seemed so adamant to avoid that topic. You know, it's, yeah. And to me, it's like, this seems like something, even if you were very pro, you know, Second Amendment, it seems like clearly there's something different that makes us different. And it's also, you would think, for conservatives, something that they could point to and say, oh, well, that's an explanation that doesn't involve, you know, a malicious cop or a malicious system, for example. But yeah, it's been strange to me how little anybody seems to want to examine the role of guns when it seems like that is one of the things that makes the United States so unique amongst comparable countries. Yeah.
Yeah, certainly. For some reason, there's a number of things worthy of more conversation that we've lost the ability to converse about around these types of issues. Maybe we never had the ability to converse about them, but we certainly don't seem to know.
Yeah, it seems that way. And I don't know if you've checked out my podcast at all, but I focus a lot on the social media and polarization topics, and between the polarization and social media kind of making the conversation more monolithic, you know, it seems to, that's what social media has a big role in, is making everyone align on one thing and talking about one thing, and then having one big conflict about that thing instead of a nuanced conversation. But yeah, that seems to be what's happening.
Yeah, nuance is impossible on social media, right? But what's scarier is long form conversations like what we're having here, which I would contend has a lot of nuance, right? It's also easy to use social media to completely remove the nuance.
Right, just take a clip out of context or whatever. Yeah.
Yeah, right. Yeah, it's scary because, like, if you wanted to wake up and surround yourself all day with only information that confirms your biases, it's scaringly easy to do that, right, on social media. And yeah, so I don't know. I have a love-hate relationship with social media. I happen to hate it this week. Maybe I'll love it again next week.
Yeah, that I'm mostly on the hate side these days. But so I'm curious of your work. Are there what are the most interesting findings from your work that stand out that you're either the most proud of or just the most interesting of, and things that we haven't discussed yet?
Well, I just going back to the body camera study, right? Because that's fresh in my mind because that's my most active project. That takes up most of my time nowadays. I think what we've come around to believing as a result of doing this project is this type of systematic review and analysis of video footage can actually do quite a bit to help support the current reform agenda. Right. So, you know, we're a lot of things that we want police officers to do, like de-escalation, like adhere to procedural justice. Standard data systems of police really can't capture those things. Right. We have no way of knowing if police are being consistently respectful to the people that they encounter in the street. Right. We could measure whether or not people complain about officers. Right. But I would contend that those are two different things, right? It's possible to be pretty rude on a consistent basis and no one take the time out of their day to go make a formal complaint against you. So kind of the one big takeaway, I think, from a practical application is we would like to see police departments develop the internal capacity to do these types of in-depth reviews and in-depth analysis of their body camera footage. To be fair, a lot of police departments do, as a policy, take random samples of footage, look at it just to make sure everything's on the up and up, use it to train officers. We would like to see that become a little bit more common, and we will also like to see technology develop that to help police do that on a little bit more in-depth level.
I was going to ask you some questions about signage that people put up to prevent theft or robbery at their home or business, sort of like the signs that people put up that might say, like, implying that we have guns in here or monitored by surveillance system type of signs. And I'm curious, basically just curious to get your take on what kind of signs do you think work in that regard? Like, say you weren't going to do anything surveillance wise, but you were just going to try to rely on a sign. Is there something that pops out to you as you would pick that type of sign in order to effectively reduce crime at your property?
Not necessarily, right? Because again, I think it's about risk communication. And I think anyone who's considering, or most people who are considering committing a crime, don't think they're at heightened risk just because a sign is telling them to, that they may be of heightened risk. Mm-hmm. What I would do is I would do things like improve the lighting around my properties, right? So that people entering or exiting are highly visible to passerbys on the street. If I owned a shop, right, I would make sure that the windows are clear of items, right? Every now and then, walking through New York City on my way to John Jay campus back in the day when we would actually, you know, do that on a consistent basis. Seeing bodegas with like paper towels stocked up on the windows and making it hard to see inside, right? I wouldn't do any of that because again, someone may feel comfortable about going in there and committing a crime because no one could see what they're doing. If my parents would ever listen to me, like I keep reminding them what I do for a living, right? I would rearrange their camera system so that the cameras were closer to the door. So then instead of getting a view of the entire shop, everyone's face is captured on camera as they walk in and they could, you know, be aware of that. You know, those are the types of adjustments I would make, right? I wouldn't put up signage to give what I think would be empty threats. I would do things that more communicated a level of heightened risk for offending behavior.
Some of those signs are interesting to me because you see the signs that are like, we have guns, we'll shoot you.
Yeah.
And that's kind of, maybe that's effective, but it also seems to me that maybe that might induce people who want to come rob your guns, you know, like, or steal your guns when you're not there or whatever. So that seems to have some sort of mixed message to me. And then even the monitored by surveillance system type of signs, you know, which some people might put up even if they don't have a system, maybe that works, but it also seems like maybe that's sending the message, we have some valuable stuff, please don't come in here. So for all of these things, it's almost like I can see even the messaging being not exactly working exactly the way you want it, even just for the signage.
Yeah, but actually that's a really good point though that you made with the distinction, right? I would contend that the alarm sign is at least an attempt at communicating heightened risk of offending, right? Maybe this house has a camera, an alarm, maybe it doesn't, right? But maybe I'll go to somewhere else where I'm certain that there is no burglar alarm. Those we have guns in the house signs, that's nonsense, because most people aren't breaking into houses when they're occupied, right? Offenders, this isn't America Ninja Warrior, right? People aren't doing
Hardly
this as a competition.
Yeah.
Yeah, like people are breaking into houses for the monetary benefits, right?
They're snatching and grabbing mostly, yeah.
Exactly, right? So they're not breaking into a house looking to have combat with an unarmed person most of the time, right? I mean, they're breaking into a house when it's convenient and easy to do so. So even that example, I would contend one sign is actually a perhaps decent risk communication device and the other one is toxic masculinity.
Yeah, or worse, it's inviting people who are going to be like, well, I'll wait till they're not there and look for their guns.
Yeah, yeah, how about, yeah, you're right. It's a target. It's the opposite of target hardening, whatever that would be.
Yeah, one thing I was going to say is, I wanted to say earlier was, on this stretch of road my parents are on in the country in rural Maryland, they had there was always people dumping trash, and so they put up a fake surveillance camera on the street, on this pole where everybody was dumping trash, and it actually worked pretty well. Like you saw the there was much less trash dumped there. And I think
that's interesting.
Yeah, I think over time, I think it stopped being as effective for some of the reasons we mentioned, but it did have the effect, you know. And they probably in with the displacement idea, they probably just dumped it a little bit in a slightly different place. So. do you have any ideas on how much deepfake technology is going to change how video surveillance and legal challenges work? You know, the technology that creates a video showing a fake video showing someone doing something. And I think clearly right now, you know, that there's artifacts in the video that can easily show that it was manipulated from a legal perspective. But I think, do you have any thoughts on how that might change in the future? Is that close to being to a point where nobody could detect it, or is that still quite far off? Maybe you know that.
I don't have any research-driven or empirical thoughts about that. My personal feeling is like I'm kind of terrified of this type of technology, right? Like I saw, maybe it was an Apple commercial or I think it was an either an iPhone commercial or a Galaxy commercial where like the new hot feature is to delete people out of photographs, right? And like that's what Kim Jong-un did in North Korea when he killed his uncle a few years ago. He had the dude digitally removed from all of the state photographs to pretend like he didn't exist, right? And now we have it on iPhones, right? So I I'm a little nervous about what government actors, for example, with obviously technology that may be a little bit better than an iPhone, are going to be able to do. And also on the criminal side too, right? I mean, maybe there's nefarious criminal implications to deepfake videos and things that seem to be coming, you know, actually fairly commonly commercially available. I'm still wrapping my mind around all of this, but I'm not a terrible fan of it. I mean, it just seems like someone's going to figure out something not good to do with those types of technologies.
Yeah, I mean, at the very least, clearly there's going to be a lot of, mass misinformation. You know, even if it's provable, it's not a real video. That clearly can spread around to people and people can believe things without it, though we might know it's completely false. Clearly that's happening now, but yeah, I think that's much more on the timeline versus, you know, the fact that probably kind of far in the future, someone will be able to make one that's indistinguishable, even at a like forensic video analysis level. That's probably, I don't know, maybe it's not too far in the future, but yeah, you can imagine that completely warping everything, because then defendants can be like, well, someone's framing me, or, you know, you have no proof that's really me, even though you have a video of me.
Yeah, no, it's, again, I mean, I haven't really wrapped my mind around all of it, so I don't have any informed opinions, but I do have opinions, and they're negative.
Yeah. Scary stuff. Yeah. Anything else you want to mention that you think would be interesting about your work, or just points that you didn't get a chance to mention so far?
Did I answer your question of why I think video surveillance cameras maybe didn't play a large role in the decline, or should I make a more definitive comment?
Well, yeah, I mean, I think you made the point that it's pretty hard to say based on the research, which is, you know, pretty much what I had read in some quick trying to peruse the reading online. But yeah, it seems harder than one would think it would be to show the correlation, no matter how intuitive it would seem to us.
Well, that too, and I'm skeptical that police on a widespread level would have been able to use the cameras in the evidence-based way that we now see is required for cameras to have large effects. My gut would tell me, and again, it's really, there's really no way to actually measure this, right? But my gut would tell me that the older systems, 80s, 90s, whenever, were probably installed and deployed in a way that it was the type of ineffective standalone camera system that we identified in our research as not being terribly effective.
Well, then there's the idea too that greater surveillance allows for more arresting of criminals and getting them off the streets, which would reduce crime. And then there's that angle of it too, right?
Yeah, and as a video surveillance researcher, I have to say that we have more work to do on that end, right? There's only a handful of studies that have looked at the investigative benefits of cameras. Some have found effects, right? A couple of the UK studies I'm thinking about, Matt Ashby did one from University College London, right? He found that there were some positive benefits to cases where video surveillance footage was utilized as evidence. There was another study out of Dallas that found something similar, but when they took a deeper look into the data, what they found was essentially it was only beneficial for theft, right? And for the more serious crimes, which cities are probably investing in cameras to prevent in the first place, there really wasn't much of an impact. Mm-hmm. So the jury's still out on that, right? This jury's still out on that. Like I hope over the next decade or so that we start generating much more research on that aspect of video surveillance.
And I guess one way to end this maybe is, it's interesting to me when I was doing some research for this and looking into some of the things I was curious about, it's just kind of interesting that it's hard to find people writing about theoretically positive impacts. Apart even from studies, it's hard to find people writing about or examining theoretically positive aspects of video surveillance or smartphone ubiquity. And I kind of wonder if it's due to kind of a common, you know, Luddite kind of anti-technology stance that I think a lot of, you know, thinking people have. There can be kind of a sense that to examine or think about the benefits might seem, you know, politically conservative or semi-authoritarian. And it's much more cool to criticize, you know, the bad effects of the surveillance state and those kinds of impacts. And I kind of wonder if, you know, because frankly, I was just surprised that I there wasn't much writing at all on, for example, examining the role of camera technology in how that progressed over the last 100 years and how that affected society, you know, and may have affected it beneficially. And it seems like there's much less work even on the research side than I would have expected.
Yeah, I'm not familiar with anything highlighting the potential positive benefits of surveillance either. And that's a really good point, really good observation.
Well, maybe.
And also your first point there in the first sentence you started with, right? Maybe it's just the times we live in. I mean, it's not cool to point out the benefits of anything, right? It seems like the standard operating procedure is to find things that outrage you.
Yeah, and it may be a bit of a search engine thing too, because maybe the search engine is, when I put in those kind of keywords, it's like, let me show you all the bad things about their surveillance state or something, you know.
That makes sense.
The research tools, you know, maybe. So I guess maybe anybody listening who may have seen that kind of work, I'd be interested to know. But all right, thanks a lot, Eric. Thanks for coming on. It's been great.
Same here.
That was Eric Pisa, who's an associate professor of criminal justice at John Jay College of Criminal Justice. You can learn more about him at his website, ericpisa.net, and you can follow him on Twitter at PisaEric. One thing I wish I had asked Eric about was a 2012 study he worked on that showed police foot patrol was an effective crime prevention tactic for street violence, murder, shootings, and non-domestic aggravated assaults. Maybe worth mentioning, if you're someone who thinks, as I do, that the number of people imprisoned in the United States is disturbing and that our prison system needs a lot of work, it's worth considering that that problem may be helped by doing more to prevent crime. To quote from a 2019 Vox article, "This sounds a little paradoxical, but the reality is the size of the prison population is driven largely by the harshness of the sentencing, not the number of police stops. The criminologist Lawrence Sherman has observed that the United States is very unusual in spending much more money on the prison system than on our police departments. This suggests the possibility of switching to a formula Tabarrak has summarized as more police, fewer prisons, less crime. Uniformed officers patrolling the streets stopping crime before it starts, rather than working in prisons surveilling convicts," end quote. This has been the People Who Read People podcast with me, Zach Elwood. You can learn more about this podcast and get episode descriptions at behavior-podcast.com. If you enjoy this podcast, please share it on social media and give it a rating on iTunes or another podcast platform. I don't make any money on this podcast, and it takes me quite a bit of time to work on, so any way you can encourage me to work more on it is appreciated. If you enjoyed this episode, you may enjoy some of the past interviews I've done, like the interview I did about police violence issues with James Mitchell, who is a retired police captain. He also happens to be politically liberal, so that aspect might make it an interesting conversation to some people. Okay, thanks for listening. Music by Small Skies.